The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I have desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me, his pavilion. A hymn of praise this morning, blessed assurance, be found in the program.
This hour of pain and this hour
memories. God is still good.
Yes, sir.
You may be in a lot of pain. You might be hurting. You shed tears. God is still good.
Yes.
Look back on the reflection of Mother Glasgow. God is still good. He's good because you are here this morning.
Mm-hmm.
He's good because he woke you up this morning.
Yeah.
He's good because he brought you over the age, highways, and byways. He's good.
Yeah.
He's good. God is good. To the family, God is good. To the friends, God is good. Regardless of what you might be experiencing this hour, God is good. Let us pray. Eternal God, the God of all flesh and the creator of all life, this once again, Father, we come, Lord, forth with our heads bowed down to Mother's earth. Realize the heavenly Father and understand that you make no mistakes. You never ever fall in your way. And Father, we just want to come right now, Father, giving you thanks. For you said by the word, Father, in all things be grateful and thankful. We thank you, Father, Lord, right now for the years of Mother Glasgow. Bless her, Father. We thank you for the years and hours and the time, Father, she was here with us, Lord, Lord. But most of all, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Son who was given. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for Jesus the Christ, thine only begotten Son. But in times like these, Heavenly Father, we need a Savior. In times like these, Heavenly Father, we need a comforter, Lord God. In times like these, Heavenly Father, you made a way, Heavenly Father, because you knew that one day we're all supposed to this path. One day we're all be sitting and looking and staring down at loved ones who have gone on. One day, Father, you made a way, Father, Lord. We ask the Lord God in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, Lord God, to hold his family, Lord God, in the hollow palms of your hand. Give them peace, Lord. Give them strength. Let them know that earth has no sorrow, Father, that heaven cannot heal. Hold this family together, Lord God. Strengthen them, Lord God. Give them the peace, Lord God. Give them the comfort that they need, Father, Lord. The Lord's Lord, brother, their father, their grandmother, help the father, their great great grandmother, father. Keep them, Father, in the hollow palms of your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Come to the Lord, Lord, right now. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Hebrews chapter 13. And he says, it's so relevant today. Let brotherly love continue. Do not forget to entertain strangers. For sometimes you entertain angels without knowing it. Remember them who are bound as bound with them, and those who suffer adversity as yourself are suffering with them. Marriage is honorable in all and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things that you have. He has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, so that you may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do to me.
Amen.
Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines, for it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace, not with meats, which have not profited them that have been occupied with such things. We have an altar where they have no right to eat which serve in the tabernacle, for the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned outside the camp. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gates.
Let us go forth therefore unto him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. By him therefore let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God, continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But to do good and to communicate, forget not. For with such sacrifices God is well pleased. Obey them that have the rule over you, and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they must give account, as they may do it with joy and not with grief. For what? That is unprofitable for you. Pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience and all things willing to live honestly. But I beseech you the rather to do this, that I may be restored to you sooner. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that is which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, whom be glory forever and ever.
Amen.
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 Second scripture reading is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, 51 through 57. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and the mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? Where is the victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I was chosen to speak on behalf of my grandmother, who has really made a lasting impression in my life. She's the matriarch of our family, the legacy of our generations, and she's now at rest. Her laughter, her joy, her cry, her smiles, her laughs, her everlasting love is implanted in our hearts. The knowledge of our heritage was all produced and given by who we call Ma, Mama, or by others, Claire. I want to thank my grandmother and Mama. I want to thank my grandmother for my mother, my uncles, because through them, she leaves an everlasting legacy of Clary Glasgow because of her spirit that lives through us. We are all spirits passing through with the privilege to leave a lasting legacy for them to give an impression to our next generation. So let us celebrate her life and not be saddened because she's not here with us no more. Mom was someone who you can always go to and get a joke from. She would always say, "Bite." "Look and see me, meet your road," or something like that. She always give me proverbs like, "Bite, moons run till they catch it." I used to be like, "Mom, what are you talking about?" But anyway, this woman was really an inspiration to me, to my brothers and sisters, to the entire generation that's here. What can I say about my grandmother? She always showed us everlasting love. She always gave. She always told us to, you know, go further in life. You know, do what you have to do to make what you have to make to get where you need to go. And that really made me the man that I am today. She said, "Lance," I remember it was one time, she said, "Lance," she said, "everything you need to know, Lance, is in the Word of God. If you follow the Word of God, your life will be flourishing." So, Grandma, though you're not here with us right now, in body, but you're with us every day, and you will be with us always in spirit. So I just want to thank you for the years that I've known you. And I know that right now you're walking on the streets of gold, preparing a place that God has already made. So when I do see you again, Grandma, I want to see that smile. I want to laugh. And I want to continue to hug you, because you'll always be in my heart. I love you, Grandma. I got one more thing on behalf of the Friendship Baptist Church of Patterson, New Jersey. Reverend James C. Woodley, the pastor, sent this message. In our time of loss, we can sometimes find ourselves overwhelmed with feelings of confusion and sorrow. Hopelessness and despair may well up in our hearts. It can seem as though comfort is beyond our reach. The word says, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." Matthew 5:4. On behalf of our sister Doreen Holder and the Friendship Baptist Church family, wants to assure you that you are in our thoughts and prayers as you go through this difficult time. We know the same God who helped you with trials in the past will be ever present to comfort you during this time.
You know, scripture says, "God of mercy and of comfort." And it's the 2 Corinthians, around the first chapter. He's the God of mercy and comfort. He'll comfort us in all our weaknesses and trials and tribulations. Comfort that he gave us that one day, I'm paraphrasing it, that one day we can take that same comfort and comfort other people with it. Let them know that God is able. Because he brought you and your family through, that he's able to take someone else. And that's what the scripture was saying when he said he's the God of all comfort. That one day, you might sit beside somebody else who's going through the same thing that you're experiencing right now. And by you knowing the God of heaven and of earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you can tell that family, say, "I know a man by the name of Jesus Christ. One day I will sit where you are." And that same God gave me the strength to hold on and to hold out. Brother or sister, it's the same thing for you. So the seats that you're in right now, someday God will bring you in contact with somebody and you can tell them the same thing that I know a man. I know a God that's able to sustain you and to keep you and to strengthen you. Our text this morning is coming from 1 Thessalonians, the the fourth chapter, starting at the 13th verse. Paul is writing to the church at Thessalonica. He said, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you, by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore comfort one another with these words." Paul, in the book of Acts, it says Paul had a vision from a man came to Paul that night. And the man told Paul to come over to Macedonia, that we need you. We need your help. We want you to come to Macedonia, Paul. Please come. And Paul realized that it was the Holy Spirit leading him to go to Macedonia. So when Paul got to Macedonia, he saw this place called Thessalonica. And Thessalonica was one of the wealthiest cities in the Roman Empire. And Thessalonica also was the capital and the largest city in the province of Macedonia. And so Paul saw all of this great city, and he said to himself, this mega metropolis city. And he said, because of the strategic position where it was located there between Macedonia and Greece, Paul, if I could just start a church right here, if I could start a church right here because of this location, that would be the hub for everybody going through this port city would come through Thessalonica. So Paul established the church in Macedonia. When he established the church, he prayed for them. They could hold on, to hold out. So Paul left when he got into some trouble because the Jews wanted to take Paul and do something to him because Paul was speaking of a coming king by the name of Jesus Christ. And the Jews didn't like that. So Paul and Silas, they left after they had established the church. Now they established the church. Paul heard the persecution that the church of Thessalonica was going through. So Paul said, tempted by it. He said, after I couldn't take it no longer, I sit tempted back to be concerned to find out about your faith, to see if the tempter had came and tempted you, and that our labor was in vain. Because of the persecution that the church was going through, Paul sent tempted back to find out how they was holding up, how they was doing. Well, he had heard about the persecution. And so when tempted came back, he came back with good news. Good news. He said, but Paul, there's something the church is worried about. He said, they want to know what happens to those who have already died ahead of us. What they see, you keep telling us all about the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. But the body want to know, those who are still alive, so some have died on and went on to be with the Lord. They want to know, with those who also experience the glory that we will see. If Christ comes back, will they see the same glory that we will see? And Paul sat down and he started to write. Paul sat down, he started to write. Well, he had told them about the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Paul said, I don't want you to be ignorant, for one thing. Because brothers, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. Paul said, I don't want you to have sleepless nights. I don't want you to be in that position where you can't think straight. I don't want you to be in a position where even if a loved one is going on, that some have even committed suicide. You don't know that. Some people have lost loved ones that have committed suicide because their loved ones went on home before them. So Paul was telling them, he said, they have no hope. Why they have no hope? Because they didn't die in the Lord Jesus Christ. They died in idols, trusting and believing in idols. They died trusting and believing in their money. They died trusting and believing in other people. They died trusting in self and believing in self. So Paul said, there's no hope for them. Because they didn't die in the Lord Jesus There's hope for you, because you have died in the Lord. And Mother Glasgow has died in the Lord. There is hope for her. But if you died without knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, folks, there's no hope for you. And he went on to tell them in verse 14, if we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who seek in Jesus. Now this is, look at this, this is the metaphor for death, for dying. Paul in the book of 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, speaks about Jesus Christ. And he breaks it down. He said that Jesus isn't only God. He said, if Jesus just only died, this is going to be different. If you only just died, the gospel is useless. If you only just died, your faith is proof. If you only just died, the measure of the cross means nothing. But he didn't only just die. He was resurrected. And that's the difference than just dying. You see, I know he died for all the sins, but by him being resurrected, That's the key component, that he was wrong, he was resurrected. And so by him being resurrected, God said that he will bring all those with him who have died in the Lord Jesus Christ. For I believe what God's word said, for God said he's not a man that he shall lie, nor the son of man that he shall repent. Whatever he has said that he will do, what he promised, he shall bring it to pass. I believe it. I don't know if you believe it, but I believe it. I believe that one day Mother Glasgow would be in heaven. She is there right now. But Paul said you'll be absent from the body, that you'll be blessed with the Lord. What we're looking at now is just an old house that she used to live in, but she's not in that house no more. And if you come back 2 or 3 years from now, if God has not taken the church, and if you go to the cemetery, you open up the grave, that old house where she lived in, that she is in house there, what you're looking at right now would still be in this casket, but her soul and her spirit has gone on to be with the Lord Jesus Christ in heaven.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes, sir.
This is just a house. Just a house she's living in. That's just a house. That's just a place that she's living in. Paul wanted the church to know that I had a text this morning, it would be, don't worry. Don't worry. It's going to be all right. Don't worry. Those who died in the Lord, Paul is saying, don't worry. There's hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. But those who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, there's no hope for them. But there's hope for you, for those who know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. There's hope for them. He says also that, for this we say to you, by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will be. Will by no means foresee those who are alive, signifying that, hey, that there will be those who will be here when Christ comes back for the church. There will be those who are here doing the will of God. There will be those who are here who will be having their hands to the plowshare and not looking back. There will be those who are here who are telling millions of boys everywhere that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world, that he died for the sins of humanity, and if you want eternal life, you can come and accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and you will be saved. There is hope in Jesus Christ. There's hope. Jesus spoke the words in the book of John. The 5th chapter, the 28th verse, said, the hour was coming that all who were in the grave would hear my voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. Jesus said that. There will come a time to call a shout. When everybody who's in the grave is going to hear the voice of our Lord and Savior,
Jesus Christ. The sister Holders, when I spoke with her last week, and she told me about her mother, how she looked at her, she could see that her breathing had started to get very weak. And she said, "Mother, it's all right. You can go ahead. We'll be all right, Mom. We'll be all right. You can go ahead." And she said about 10 to 15 minutes after that, her mother had sighed. And it's as if her mother was waiting to hear what she had to say, or waiting on the words that said, "We'll be all right. You can go, Mama. We're okay." But I remember Jesus on the cross in the last chapter of Luke, when he said, "Unto thy hand, speak to the Father, unto thy hand I give thy spirit." And he breathed his last breath. She breathed her last breath. But I want you to know that her last breath was the final breath. I want you to know that right now, Mother Glasgow is in the heaven with Jesus Christ. She's not here. I don't care what you're looking at. I told you before, it's just an old house that she used to live in. She's not there anymore. But Paul would say, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Now henceforth laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me, but not only me, but all those who love his appearance." There's a cross laid up for Mother Glasgow, for all those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm so glad Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would not have told you so. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go, I will come back and to receive you myself. But where I am, there he may be also. And where I go, you may go." And John looked at him and said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus looked at John and said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes unto the Father except by me." I want you to know that if you want to see Mother Glasgow again, you have to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. That the Lord made it possible that one day when you was a little kid, you was a little children, God made a way that she took care of you. God made a way that she provided for you. God made a way that she fed you. God made a way that she prayed for you. But right now the time has came. The Bible says once a man and Christ a child. And now here we go. Now here it is. Now you take care of Mama. Now you raise Mama. Now you feed Mama. Now you take care of Mama. Now you're praying for Mama. Everything is switched around now. Everything is switched around. Once a man and Christ a child. Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. So many of the mothers over here in nursing home. But I can't handle it. I can't do it. I don't have the time. I can't do it. But look at you. You're still strong. You did what the Lord asked you to do. You was there for every day, 24/7. You was there for your mother. Because one day she was there for you. When you couldn't take care of yourself, you couldn't do nothing for yourself. You couldn't feed yourself. You couldn't put on pampers. But now you put pampers in that car. You feed her when she can feed you. Look before that. Make a way. This old earthly tabernacle that we live in. Every now and then it beats it. Every now and then there's no earthly tabernacle get the holes in it. When you used to hop and jump and praise the Lord, now you just wave your hand. When you be strutting, walking, now you take little steps with a cane. This old earthly tabernacle that we live in, every now and then they get weak. Don't think because what you feel violent strength that you have now, when you turn 95 years old, you'll be still doing the same thing. Maybe. But don't bail it. What you do now, Will you live to be 80 years old, 75, 85, 90? Watch the difference. Watch what happens to the body. But God has made a way. And like I said, Jesus Christ is the way. This old house that we live in, there is a thing called repossessions. When the banks also foreclosures. When the banks want to take back the house. Listen to me. When the bank comes to take back the house that you used, that they own and they gave to you under some mysterious reason, when the rules are known, you couldn't pay for the house. But they gave you the house anyway. And so this old house that we live in, when the banks do come take that back, the mortar and the bricks and the cement and the lumber and the sheetrock, the banks rebuild that house. They take the occupants out of the house. But this house that we live in, the house that was made by God Himself, that house, when God come back to claim the occupants of this house, this house don't help them. The occupants of this house don't help them wander, looking for somewhere to stay. Because we have a house not made by man, that's eternal in the heavens. We have a place where we can go. We have to worry about where our furniture is going. We have to worry about our children. We have to worry about what's going to happen. We have to worry about what's going to happen now and what's going to happen tomorrow. We have to worry about the bills that we pay. Because this house here and the occupants of this house, when God comes back for foreclosure and says, you've been down there a long time. I want to bring you home now. Sister Glasgow was suffering long enough. And I heard God say, when he sat upon his throne, he told one of his angels to go down now and dispatch. I want to dispatch one of my angels. Go down now and bring my daughter home. She has suffered enough. No more bleeding. No more testing. No more urine testing. Go down and bring my child home. She suffered enough. And while everybody was going about their daily business, not knowing, God reached out and grabbed one of his loved ones. God reached down and grabbed one of his brother ones. God reached down and grabbed one of his children. Let me tell you something. What the Bible says, he looked not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are eternal, and things that are not seen are eternal. Let me tell you something. What you see here, the condition you was in, is not in heaven. Diabetes is not in heaven. High blood pressure is not in heaven. Amputees is not in heaven. Stroke is not in heaven. Heart attack, you won't find it in heaven. No Lord, no Lord, no blood pressure, you won't find in heaven. High blood pressure, you won't find in heaven.
Yes.
You won't find it there. But it's here on earth.
Yeah.
But in heaven. All these things that we're experiencing out here, all the temporary things. That's all they are. Temporary. They're only here for a while. And if going to happen, if it so happens that you die with it, and you die in the Lord, when you go there, it's not going to be there. Blindness is not in heaven. It's not there. But it's here on earth. But it's not there. So we don't worry about these things in the spirit of God's own life. We don't worry about it. Because up there, it's not there. It's not there in heaven. And the word of God says, His word says, that we as a people, we read the scripture and it said that the last shall be first and the first shall be last. And I'm looking at this and the people at Thessalonica, the young church wanted to know about those. Well, are we going to receive them? Well, the Bible says, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Did she die? She was the last one to die, so she'll be the first one resurrected. Oh, oh,
come on.
Come on!
Did you hear that? Huh? Huh? She got an ass, so she should be the first one to break it. Because you allowed it to go before her. She died in the Lord before you died. Although you wouldn't even have even died yet. So the Lord, since she died already in the Lord, I'm going to bring her first. And then those who are alive will be caught up. And Paul went on to say, comfort one another with these words. And this is what I want to leave with you. Comfort one another. Talk to your family members. Let them know that mother is in a better place now. She's well off, she's better off, and she's with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where she is now. Let nobody tell you anything different. Nobody. I don't care what nobody says. I believe what God's word says. He said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. God is going to comfort this family. He will not leave you out there wondering, thinking, but his word, Romans, it's 15th chapter of Romans, round the fourth verse, it reads that all the things that were written was written for our learning, that we, through the scripture, through the patience and the scriptures, might have hope. So when you are down and out and can't find your way, the Bible says there's hope in the scripture. Pick up God's word and read the word, how he brought so many out. So many. He's going to do the same thing for this family. The same thing he's going to do for you as well. Mother, rest on. Because I know, if nobody else knows, if you die in the Lord, you have rest, Mama. You have peace now. No! No more suffering. No more pains. We who are here now. We gotta worry about what's gonna happen with us. We got to never know. One day, just a minute, one day, you might have to go through what Mama went through. You don't know. You don't know what life holds for you. But you know one thing, and I know one thing. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. I am assured that God holds tomorrow. And if I continue to believe and accept Christ as my personal Lord and Savior, whatever comes tomorrow, God knows already. Whatever's going to happen next week, God knows already. Don't have to take God by surprise. Whatever happens, God already knows it's going to happen before you even knock on your door. God already knows about it. Amen. So accept Christ now as your personal Lord and Savior. He's the way, the truth, and the life. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. May God put his arms around you and keep you and hold you in the hollow palms of his hands continuously. Yes, my prayer. Amen.
Amen. Celebration of life for your beloved Janet Clarissa Glasgow. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Reverend Sebron Griffin for his comforting words and prayers which he has shared with the family, Anthony and Lance, for their readings, and to everyone else for whatever role you may have played or you may be playing in making this time of transition somewhat easier for the family. To the family, once again, on behalf of Eternity Funeral Services, we continue to encourage all of you. Friends, Ms. Glasgow will be laid to rest in the Mount Carmel Cemetery, located in Englewood, New Jersey, in accordance with her family's wishes.
Sing the wondrous love of Oh, the cemetery now for the burial. It's kind of sad. People really missing her, even though she had a really full life and more. It's a really hot day. It's supposed to be in the 90s. I'm sweltering here. She's a real nice woman.
Great mother. A mother is a key, is the key to life. She is the beginning, middle, and end. A mother is your guidance, at the same time your friend. A mother defines trust. A mother defines love, but a great mother defines all of the above.
That's it.
A great mother will take your negatives and find a way to make them positive. A great mother can change your bad days whenever you're feeling opposite. Life without a mother, love, is basically no life. But life with a mother, love, is like living life twice. A mother will care with perfection. So with all of this being said, it's time to give it right back. And let's show that we care to a friend, a mother, a grandmother, a sister, and show her that she will be truly missed and never forgotten. A great mother like Clarissa is a blessing from above.
Also blessing in the name of the Most High. You know, let's come back. Norman make I know the Gibbs family. And since I know the Gibbs family, I get to know the mother, brother, everybody. And they were so good to me. And I don't forget good. In the chapel there, the first thing that sang said, "This is my story." All of us got a story.
Mm-hmm.
But it's how we can tell it. You understand? The most important thing is not how long we live, it's the good that we do. And I would never forget the Gibbs family. As long as they need me, I'm going to be here for them.
After we met, Clarissa stuck to me like paint on a wall. I don't make it very easy for people to like me, and I make no apologies for that. But Clarissa was one that I really am grateful for, and I pray that God will open his door and let her see the light of his face. She was a good woman. Amen.
Great woman.
Amen.
Great woman. Great woman.
They had to pray. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. Let this not be the last day that we all get together just because it's death. But let us love one another as we love each other right now, Father God. As we say farewell to our grandmother, mother, friend, we just ask you right now, God, to give us peace. And we ask you right now to give us the strength to be able to see her go away, Father God. We thank you right now. And we ask you right now to open up our hearts and keep our minds set upon you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Though he save me, yet will I trust in him. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, that he shall stand at the latter days upon the earth, whom I shall seek myself, my eyes shall behold, and not another. For as much as it had pleased Almighty God in his great mercy to take unto him the soul of our dear sister, here departed, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust, in this sure and certain hope of the resurrection of life eternal through our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our corrupted body, that it may be like unto his glorious body, according to the working of his mighty power, whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, the creator of all life and the God of all flesh, Father, we come now asking for your strength. We come now, Father, asking for your comfort. We come now, Heavenly Father, asking that those who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, Lord, Father, you move upon their hearts right now, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for the years, Mother Glasgow. We thank you for the years, Father God, she was with us. For you said in that word, be grateful and thankful for all things. Yes, I have found out that even death, we should be grateful and thankful. For the years and the times you let her be here. For the smiles, Lord God. For the wisdom and the knowledge she gave her children and her grandchildren and her great-great-grandchildren. We thank you, Father, right now. But Heavenly Father, we pray right now, Lord God, for this family. That you'll hold them, Father, that you'll keep them. That you'll guide them, Lord God. The comfort, Lord God, of that Holy Spirit, Lord God. And let them know earth has no sorrow, but heaven cannot heal. And as the day approaches and goes on, help the Father, day help the Father. We want you, Heavenly Father, to intervene, Lord God, in their lives. Let them know that you're a father to the fatherless and a mother to the motherless, Lord God. Hold them now, Father, in Jesus Christ's name. And all those who are traveling over the highways and byways, Father God, we are praying right now, Lord God, that you give them health and mercy and grace. That the blood of Jesus Christ will be upon them, Lord God, as they travel back down south, Lord God, or wherever they came from, Father. That the blood of Jesus Christ will be a sign upon them, Lord God. That your angels will continue to watch over them and protect them, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name, this is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Gotta move back a little bit, watch yourself. Gotta move back a little bit.
How precious is that grace appear? The hour I first is me.
Right, shining as the sun,
with no less days to sing God's praise than when He first began.